As the debate continues about the nation's new health reform law, in the courts and on the campaign trail, the Kansas Health Institute has asked some experts to share their views. These interviews with providers, public officials, and people on the business side of healthcare are intended to help Kansans better understand how the law will affect them and help them sort fact from fiction and policy from politics.
We've tried very hard from the standpoint of a plaintiff in this lawsuit to focus not on the policy questions, but on the underlying legal questions. It's not that the Attorney General's office has a view on what federal policy on health care ought to be. It's that we have strong feelings about how the Constitution ought to be interpreted in terms of how it gives power to the federal government or denies power to the federal government. On the two large constitutional issues that are at stake in this litigation, one, the so-called individual mandate, is a case of first impression, a claim of power by the Congress that it never before has claimed in 220 years of American history. The people of the United States have granted to the federal government the power to tax and to spend. If Congress had relied on either of those authorities in order to pass the Affordable Care Act and the provisions that required funding, we wouldn't be having this legal debate. Instead, they decided to manufacture a new and never-before-tried power, which is essentially the power to compel individuals to spend in pursuit of a federal objective. Part of the federal government's argument on the mandate is that the healthcare market is somehow unique, because we will all require healthcare at some point during our lives, and so then you get into the cost-shifting arguments and that sort of thing. Even if that is true, that still doesn't grant Congress a power that doesn't exist in the Constitution. No matter how well-intended Congress may be or how great the need on a policy side, Congress may not exercise a power that it does not have under our Constitution. And that's what we're fighting about in terms of the individual mandate. And on the other constitutional issue, the Medicaid expansion, we've obviously been on a trajectory, at least since the New Deal, of broad deference by the courts to congressional assertions of authority under the spending clause, where Congress says, if we give you this money, state, you must do these things. But the court has always said that although the case in front of it didn't exceed the constitutional boundary, the court's been careful to say there is a limit. And our argument essentially in this case is we think this case crosses the limit, largely because of the magnitude, the huge dollar amounts involved. One of the seminal cases on testing the limits of the spending power is South Dakota versus Dole. In that case, Congress threatened to withhold 5% of the state's allocation of highway money if the states didn't do what Congress wanted, raising the drinking age. In this case, all of the state's Medicaid matching money will be withheld if we don't accept the expansion. Medicaid for most states is either the largest, second, or third largest component of their state budget. For better or for worse, every state has become reliant upon federal aid as the way that we deliver that basket of social services. The reality is, no state is going to withdraw from the federal Medicaid program. At some point, this offer of the federal government to give money in exchange for things it could not otherwise compel states to do becomes so coercive, the language the court has used, that the states really don't have a choice. And so we think there's not only a difference in degree, there's a difference in nature of the threat that's out there, and we'll see whether the court agrees. This legal fight is not going to resolve the underlying issues in the healthcare access, delivery, and financing circumstances that brought us to this point in the first place. Our position is not that nothing should happen. Our position is that, if I can use a crude metaphor, Congress has to color within the lines. And our role as state AGs and plaintiffs in this case is to police what we believe the lines to be in terms of the constitutional authority of the federal government and the precedents that will be set.